You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View, a podcast where we talk to screenwriters about screenwriting. I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, and today we've got two great guests on who wrote a movie together called Gold. Patrick Massett and John Zinman are writing partners and producers on TV and movies. They've worked on stuff like Caprica, Friday Night Lights, Blacklist, and today, like I said, we'll be covering Gold, a new movie coming out soon. Guys, thank you so much for joining us.
Pleasure, thank you.
Our pleasure, great to be here. Thanks for having us.
All right, so I'm going to start. I'll let you guys discuss who's going to take this first question. One thing I'd like to do first to change it up a little bit, normally I ask how you guys got started in the business, but first I'd really want to hear, can you guys pitch us Gold? Because the story just seems so fantastic that it's a little larger than life. It's a little weirder than real life.
Yeah, Gold is about a guy named Kenny Wells who is a gold prospector, a minerals prospector, working in Reno, Nevada. He is the third generation of a family that, you know, went out west and found their livelihood in mining, in searching for minerals. When we meet Kenny, he's at a very low ebb in his life, but he has this drive. He has this desire to really prove himself, and he literally has a vision that there's gold in Indonesia. And he hooks up with someone he knew back in better days, named Mike Acosta, and together they go into the jungles of Indonesia and make what is the largest gold strike in the history of mining. And from that point, it's a wild ride, and all the sharks begin to circle, all the things that money of beyond anyone's imaginings brings out of the woodwork, all the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I don't want to give away the ending, but he learns the true meaning of gold in the course of the story.
Sure.
Now, do you want to add anything to that?
No, that was great. I was just going to say, you know, we were going to call it Good, Bad, and the Ugly, but that title was taken. When John was talking about Kenny's, you know, starting out, you know, his business had been diminished. You know, the real guy was working out of a bar. You know, so he really, really starts kind of rock bottom. And you know, when he has that vision, he's kind of in this drunken stupor, and he has this dream that there's gold, and he goes, and he finds it, and like John said, it brings out the best and the worst in people.
Yeah, I think that's definitely apparent from the movie. So let's backtrack then and talk about, you guys have been working as a partnership for quite some time. How did you guys start working together? John, you want to take that?
Sure. Patrick and I met while we were both members of the Fountainhead Theater Company in Hollywood, and both of us were writers and actors, and you know, we were young and doing our thing. And I had recently sold a script, and Patrick was finishing a script that he was going to be going out with, and I read it and was really impressed with it, and it did subsequently sell, and we went out to celebrate, and in that. There were, you know, probably a good number of drinks involved, and we were like, oh, yeah, we should do something sometime. And so it was somewhat accidental, but before the night was over, we had an idea, and I'm pretty sure that the next day we started working on a script together.
Wow.
And, you know, a part of the reason for that is that I had a child on the way and was kind of flat broke, so we had to beat the birth to get the script out.
Wow.
And that script did not sell, but it got us to the attention of Larry Gordon, who hired us to do an adaptation of a video game called Battlezone. And then we were off to the races, and we've been partners ever since.
Wow. So, Patrick, what came next for you guys? I mean, there was assignments and then more assignments, or were there more specs? What was the next couple steps you guys took?
Well, after we had finished Battlezone for Larry Gordon, you know, John had noticed this giant cardboard cutout of Laura Croft sitting in the office.
Wow.
And they really loved the script, but it was massive. I mean, it would be difficult to make it now. It was just a really big, big idea, and we just wrote a very big, you know, expensive script. But they loved the writing, and they asked us what we wanted to do next, and I think we both pointed to the giant cardboard cutout of Laura Croft, and they said, "No, no way. We're going to the, you know, the biggest, you know, 5-star guys, AAA writers only." And I think we felt a little wounded by that. We went home. We had a great idea. We kind of worked up this pitch, and we called our agents and said, You need to call those guys back and tell them, we're going to write this thing, and they're going to have to buy it and pay top dollar for it, or they're going to have to hear our pitch. So we kind of strong-armed a little bit into hearing it. We went in. Larry was there. Stephen Herrick was directing it at the time. And Larry Lloyd Levin, I think, was in the room. And we walked them through it, man, beat for beat, the whole movie, the way we saw it. And before we got off the Universal lot, our agents had called and said they wanted to take us to Paramount. We went into Paramount, pitched it to John Goldwyn, and I think it was more like a filibuster than a pitch. It was like, we weren't leaving the room until you bought it. it was a greenlit movie that time. And then, they bought it, and then we went to work. We got Angelina Jolie, and they went through some crazy shit with Simon West and Trip to London, and the first draft of that we wrote that we sent into Paramount, I think we wrote it in 3 weeks. Because wow. They had a serious, crazy, like $6 million, payment to make to Eidos. So they had to have a draft that they felt they could make the movie with. And they've been trying to get a draft for a couple of years.
Wow.
And then the story, there's a lot of story here that goes on and on about that. But basically it got made. It made a lot of money. It wasn't the script or the draft of the version that we were really hoping it would be. That happens a lot. And But it got us rolling, and it got us our next step, which is a step towards television, and a show that was sort of in a similar vein as Tomb Raider.
John, what was it like to make that transition into TV? I mean, what changed? What did you guys start seeing differently?
Well, coming off of the Tomb Raider experience, which was, it was both thrilling and disappointing, because the draft we originally wrote, we really loved. I mean, we had great affection for that project, both because it was such a huge opportunity for us, and also because we were just really loved the script. And the process does not. The director we were working with, Stephen Herrick, fell out of the project, and Simon had a version of the movie he wanted to do. And it was, again, we were under an enormous time constraint, and we flew to London and wrote that script in 17 days or something. And the movie did not come out the way we had hoped, and it was not our version of the script. So when TV came and we ended up, we sold a show called Veritas to ABC, and through someone's oversight, we ended up being the showrunners, and we had never done TV. So it was really an unusual situation, but we found ourselves running this action adventure, character drama in Canada, and they kind of just maybe forgot about us. We're not sure how it happened, but what we discovered was that we were in charge.
Wow.
And that scripts got rewritten when we said they got rewritten, and how would we said they got rewritten, and we cast the show and we edited the show, with the editors, of course. I don't want to diminish anyone's role, but we oversaw all of these functions, and we saw the collaboration from a completely different vantage point, which was us at the center of it, which is very different from the movie business for a writer. So TV had an enormous appeal just from the creative involvement that you can immerse yourself in TV from a writer's point of view. They're night and day. Now, film remains something we love, but it's a different experience being a film writer than being a TV writer-producer.
Yeah, I mean, it just sounds like the amount of control you have, and it's just totally different from when you're handing over a script to someone and hoping for the best.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah. So you guys had Veritas. I didn't realize you guys had created that. That's one big experience. And then you started working in TV on other people's projects. Patrick, what was that like?
Well, I mean, the first thing that we really jumped into that had any longevity was Friday Night Lights. And that was amazing. I mean, Jason Kadams, Pete Berg had done the film and the pilot, and Jason came in to run it. And, John, I think, ran into Jason at a Starbucks or something and said we had read the script and loved it. And Jason's like, why don't you guys come over and meet? And we had pretty much gotten hired, out of Starbucks, I think. I don't think I've ever met Jason, to be honest with you. So Starbucks is still a hot place to find work. went to work, on that show, and it was just incredible. It was an incredible group of people. The writing staff was amazing. All the guys that worked on it, the directors, the acting was stellar, and the show found its legs, and Pete was always there to champion it. And honestly, it's like having being on Veritas and having our own show and running our own show and then being a part of that team were two really, really outstanding experiences. I mean, I can't complain. Honestly, I think the Friday Night Lights experience will probably be something that John and I will chase for a long time. We've had great rooms and worked with other great executives and showrunners on other shows subsequently, but that was very special for us. It was a very special 5 seasons.
Wow.
I wish I could throw some drama into that, but I can't. I think the most drama we ever had was that I think we had to throw out one script in all 5 seasons. That was like the worst things ever got. Hmm. Other than that, it ran pretty smoothly.
Wow.
Yeah.
John, what was the one thing that you took away from that experience a couple of years on Friday Night Lights? I mean, that was a big show. It was a hit and it was critically acclaimed. What was the thing you guys feel like you learned from that?
Jason Kadams is a great showrunner and a great guy. And one of the things I think we took away from that is he obviously took a lot of care in casting his room. It was a diverse group of people. I say this without any self-congratulations, but I think it was a smart group of people, a talented group of people, and he respected everybody. And there were no wrong answers. And as guys who have gone on to run rooms and run shows, the lesson I think we learned is that it doesn't have to be a calamity or an emergency. We'd get to work around 10, we'd shoot the breeze for a little while. We'd work through lunch usually because it was casual. You know, we'd have everyone order out, bring lunch, and 4 or 5 o'clock, we were done. We never pulled all-nighters. We were never late on a script. Hmm. Just, you know, this slow and steady, open floor. There was no hierarchy. Mm-hmm. It was a very egalitarian environment. And subsequently, you know, we're really good friends with pretty much everybody we worked with on that show. And I think if you talk to anyone who ever worked on Friday Night Lights, they'd all say the same thing, that it's a highlight, if not the highlight of their career.
Let's get to talking about Gold and how this came together and how you guys found this project and how that all began.
We found the project. I mean, John and I were looking for something to do to get back into feature, to sort of, you know, reintroduce ourselves and kind of a new calling card. Mm-hmm. And we were both looking for stuff. And I just happened to run across a documentary late one night watching, I don't know, it was History Channel or History Channel 2 or something. And there was this like mastermind documentary. It's half hours, you know, like little crime dramas or whatever. And it sort of laid out the Briac story. And, you know, had talked about David Walsh and about, you know, he working in the mining industry and having a dream and going to Indonesia and finding gold. Then there was fraud. Then talked about this guy, Michael de Guzman, jumping out of a helicopter at the end. I mean, it just kind of laid out like this spectacular, you know, epic kind of adventure, smart adventure film. Mm-hmm. Called John, had him look at it. He called me the next day and said, wow, man, this is great. We should do it. And, you know, we went to work at that point to find out if anybody else had it. I mean, our first thought was, you know, someone's got to have this story. It's such a great story. It's a big story. There's a lot of press on it. There are some books written about it. And, you know, our people went to work and they couldn't find it. It wasn't out there.
Wow.
So at that point, we decided to spec it. And I'll let John pick it up from here. But, yeah, we decided to pitch it. The first step was to pitch.
Yeah. We dug in. We did a lot of research. So we read a lot of contemporaneous reportage from the time of the Briac story, and it was a Canadian story, which I think accounts for why maybe American film companies weren't aware of it. But you know, the story laid out so well, and it was so rich thematically with you know ambition and greed and money and gold and all the things that gold traditionally represents. Resonates with Treasure of the Sierra Madre and Wall Street, and, you know, more recently Wolf of Wall Street and, you know, The Big Short and all these. Obviously, it's a theme that has been well mined, if you'll forgive the pun. And so we put the story sort of fell into place very easily, and we went out and we pitched it. We thought, hey, this is a great story. Let's go sell it. And everyone loved it. We got universal interest, except the refrain that we kept hearing was, this is a execution-dependent story.
what does that phrase mean to you guys when you hear that?
That just sort of means like your guys aren't the guys to do it. so we, you know, we licked our wounds and, you know, sucked up our pride, and we got to work. We said, well, this is, we really believed in the story. We knew somehow just elementally, we knew this was the one. And we spec'd it. And like we said, we were working on Friday Night Lights. So it was a, during hiatus, catch-as-catch-can writing process. We had put together an outline for the pitch, so we weren't starting from scratch. We expanded on that outline, and we just divvied it up, and we would write when we could write and then swap pages. And it took us a little longer than I think it typically would for a writing process. But when it was done, it was something we were really, really proud of, and we felt that we had something special.
Wow. Now, is this always, and Patrick, I'll put this to you, is it always so easy for you guys to agree on the next project to do? Do you both always just jump right in with both feet like this?
No.
Yeah.
Absolutely not. I think that's part of, the difficult part and the really good part about a partnership is you got to find stuff that you both believe in, but both of us have to connect with the material in different ways. And we both have to feel strongly about whatever is. I mean, if you're doing a film, it could take you a year or two to write it, and God knows how many years to get it made. If you're in television, you could be on that ride for years and years. So you really have to think about what you want to do and make sure it's how you want to spend the years of your life. Mm. It doesn't. And John and I haven't written that many specs. We've done a lot of assignments, and as you know, a lot of television. But I think we've only done two specs, and I think over the last in 18 years. And that's, I think, partially because it's hard to find something that we both just totally believe in, and are willing to take that chance. At the same time, I think you can, in partnerships, you can find ways too. If one person really feels strongly about something and they want to do it, there are ways of managing that as well. So one is in more of a support role.
That's great. So what is it? What is it about this process that you said took a little longer? I mean, if you guys pitched around first, was that just to try to save time and try to get that commitment from someone else's investment?
Well, writing a spec is
it's speculative.
It's speculative. I think we pitched it because we wanted to get paid. Mm-hmm. We didn't. So it was a bit of a gut check. It's like, well, how much do we really believe in the story, and how much do we really believe in ourselves? And the answer was, let's do it. I mean, we really, like I said, had just a gut sense that this was a story that we couldn't let get away.
Yeah. All right. Let's talk about that process for the two of you guys. You decide to sit down and spec this out. What are the first things you start to do? What part of the process comes first for you guys?
I think it's different with every project. And John, jump in any time here, man. But I think it's different for every project, Pete. It's like, you have to, what's the biggest, what's the sort of the biggest piece of the puzzle you have to take a look at? And I think with Gold, I think we kind of knew the story, and we kind of understood who, I think Walsh or Kenny Wells kind of came out of both of our, our alter egos in some degree, believe it or not. But it was trying to find the structure, the way to tell the story, to how to cover so much time. And, the whole film is actually a flashback until the last scene, and there's also a flashback within a flashback. So I think we looked around a lot and to figure out how to structure this thing and to tell this sort of the epic story, in a very efficient, pacey kind of way. And I think what we looked about was Nick Pelagia's script, Goodfellas, and we looked at Amadeus, the interview. Mm. And that helped us sort of understand, okay, this is how we can tell the story together. We had a little bit of a structural language that we were playing with. And then, then Kenny Wells just kind of came to life for us. John, you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I think the biggest, there was something that we both hooked in so quickly and powerfully with the story, with the character of Kenny Wells, and the real character, David Walsh, whom Kenny is inspired by, and just this idea of what it means to be a success, and that sort of this American male need for praise and success and belonging, and he was such a character of he was sort of written off, and no one wanted him in their club type of guy, and there was something just so powerful about the need coming off of this guy that was, you know, the potential for disaster with him was so great and so dramatic that I think we hooked into that really easily. So the challenge did become, how do you tell his story knowing what the end of it is without telegraphing the ending and yet being able to cover such a large period of time and so much event? And you know, it was the Amadeus, the Goodfellas model. Really, I think Amadeus was the first thing that really made us go, wait, we can do this, because it does end. I don't know when your listeners are going to listen to this. I don't want to give away the ending, but the events do avail themselves to this interview process.
Yeah, they certainly do. They certainly
and
do.
Keeping it a mystery as to what the actual nature of that interview is was part of the script from the get-go. And the sort of peeling back the layer of, wait a second, something is not quite as we think, and then sort of turning over the final card. In the original script, it wasn't until the very last scene of the interview scene that you kind of got the full picture of what it was about.
That's great. I mean, I certainly see that now that you mentioned it. That's the device in from the beginning.
Yep.
And it does occur to me that you guys have to honor the real story. You don't get to compress this down to a few days or a few months. It's a long story.
Yeah.
And it spans a lot of people and a lot of time.
Yeah.
What are the other characters that were really pivotal in creating the script, and how did you know who was going to play where and how? I'm sure there are a million other people involved in this story that we don't see on screen.
There are. The character that we invented was Kay. The real David Walsh was married and had kids. And, you know, one of the things we felt that having him be someone still pursuing this dream and sort of putting off love until he could get there. And there was another part of it. He's such a self-destructive character that we felt that someone who is self-destructive is someone you can get behind, but someone who is self-destructive and bringing a family down with them might be harder for an audience to get behind as well. And so having the sense of aspiration, both romantically and career-wise, gave him more rooting interest, we felt. So the Kay story became really important to ground and humanize Kenny. But other characters, like, you know, certainly the Mike Acosta character is essential to the story, because one of the things, you know, you go, this ultimately is a story about about friendship, about loyalty, and about trust. And you know, wouldn't have that story without the relationship between Mike and Kenny. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. That would be, I mean, that is a pivotal point throughout. All right. Well, I don't want to give away too much of the movie because it's not out yet. We still got to get a chance to see it. But I wanted to see if we could talk about some of the career and business stuff that's gone on during this time, because I know you guys switched agencies not all that long ago. Am I right?
Yes.
Is that something we can talk about? I mean, what's that like to go through? I don't think we've ever gotten the chance to kind of ask writers what was that step and what were you guys looking for?
You know, we loved those guys at CAA. You know, all the people that we were working with, they were great people. They worked really hard for us for a long, long time. It's just, I think, Pete, it's just at times you just need to shake things up. You look for some change. And, you know, John and I have been doing it for a long time. And I think we just wanted to shake things up and just to keep the business fresh. And that was pretty much the root of it. Not that they had done anything wrong or that we were unhappy in any way, but it was really about just getting some fresh people on the team. And WME, you know, they were the guys that we felt could do it, and they've been great for us ever since. It's tough. I mean, it is difficult because, you know, you build these relationships over years and you go through a lot of stuff, and it's kind of like breaking up, and it's hard.
Yeah. I mean, I have to imagine, I don't see this from the same perspective. You guys have been in the business far longer, but what are you guys looking for when you are looking for that agent? What were you looking for that landed you at WME that said this is going to be the place we go?
John, well, you want to tell a story about when we're casting shows and we're trying to get writers, just about how good WME is? I'll say, when we're trying to get writers, we're trying to staff writers on a show. Mm-hmm. it's like the best writers and the most aggressive agents are WME.
Okay.
I mean, it's just Johnny. Would you like?
Yeah, I mean,
care to elaborate on that?
That was a big deal. We had had discussions with other agencies. It always happens. Like, yeah, there was a time when we were going to make a move and we didn't feel the timing was right. But we, you know, these guys, you keep a relationship. People check in. And so we were, you know, hiring on a show, and it just sort of occurred to us that, God, we're getting a ton of calls from WME, and like a lot of the writers that we're looking at are WME clients. And in truth, we also, UTA was also pretty high on that list. And, but shockingly to us was we weren't getting as many people submitted from CAA. And, we had been toying with the idea of maybe shaking things up, and WME just did such a good job of getting their people on our show that we kind of said, huh, you know what, maybe now is the time to make that
right. Certainly it would be something.
It's not like we could say our career was in bad shape. I mean, we had just come off running a show, a network show. I mean, we had a movie going into production. It's not like, oh, we were in a crisis and needed to make a move. It was just a feeling thing of it's time to just shuffle the deck.
Well, we really appreciate your honesty on that, because I know that's not always an easy thing to talk about, but it doesn't sound like that was a bad situation for you guys to go through.
It was just uncomfortable.
Yeah.
But Jeff Gorin at WME and Paul Haas and Mark Corman were the guys that brought us in, and they're awesome.
That's and great. Now we've been working with Miesh Prabhu. I might be mispronouncing your name, Miesh, and I apologize. But he is also really a great agent for us on the film side.
That's great.
Rockstar.
Well, let's talk about some of the other business stuff.
We're going to shout out actual agents, though. We have to also say the agent who was covering our show at WME was Alyssa Bauer. And she was the one who was doing such a great job for her clients, getting our attention, which was like, you know, WME's worth another look. So if we're going to be using specific names, I want to make sure we mention Alyssa as well.
Sure, that's great. I mean, that's such a great feeling to know that, oh, this person gets other people work. I should find out why that's so different.
Yeah.
That's cool. But one of the other business things I wanted to ask about is that, I mean, I don't know what your status is now, but I know we've never gotten a chance to talk about it on the show before, but you had an overall deal at Sony for a while. Is that still something current?
Yep. Still at Sony.
So what's that like? What does that mean to have an overall deal? What was the origin of that? And can you guys kind of walk us through?
John, you want to take that one? You want to go back to the get down?
Well, yeah, we had an overall deal at 20th, and then we moved where we worked on a show with Sean Ryan and also with Hart Hansen, and those were really great experiences. And when Sean had a show over, when his deal moved to Sony, we ended up going on a show of his. I think it might have been Last Resort. And we did an overall deal with that show at Sony. And we really liked the people over at Sony. We really liked the people over 20th, by the way. You know, we've been very fortunate to have really great people that we've been working with. But the deals are, I think they're really designed to keep upper-level people in the bullpen. Mm-hmm. You know, they want us to be on shows. They want us to either run or be, you know, strong number twos on their shows, and also to develop and, you know, have first dibs on our development. And I think it's been a fairly recent resurgence in the overall deal. And it's a good, you know, it is restrictive in some ways, because you can't just sell to anybody. You have to sell to people that your home studio has a relationship with, has a business model with. You know, we can't, for example, do foreign pre-sale type of shows. We can't go over and sell territories, which is an emerging model for getting shows made. On the other hand, it's a relationship. We have a home. We have a group of people who we have develop a shorthand with, and they know where our enthusiasms lie, and we know where their needs lie, and we can, you know, have a more collaborative experience that way. And you know, of course, you get paid. You know, that's always there's a degree of security in having an overall deal.
Sure.
So yeah, we've always liked the idea of putting down roots. We've always been relationship based. I think so much of this business is relationship based, and Sony's been a really great home for us, and hope it goes on for a while.
Yeah, Sony's been terrific. You know, they've been really creative in terms of how to get our different material to the market. Like right now, we have two really big projects. One is, you know, basically we've developed with John Hinckley, who is part of Google and Google Maps, but it's got Michael Dinner attached to it. They didn't want to sell it as a pitch, so we wrote they let us write the script on a spec. And now we have like a package that we're going to go out with at the top of the year, which is really exciting. There's a book that WME brought us that they got excited about. Antoine Fuqua is attached to direct that. So it's nice having a buyer basically for you. I mean, in the sense that, you know, we couldn't have gone out and gotten that book right. on our own. They did it for us, and as a result, we now have this great. And we have two really solid packages going into 2017, and a lot of that I think is a. Hats off to Sony for letting us, think differently in terms of how to put things together.
That's great. It sounds like they really have some trust in you guys at that point. They're saying, your brains work great. Let's keep them here and here. Fix this for us.
Yeah. Yeah. And like John said, keeping us in the bullpen too. If you know, all else fails, we can go run a show for them. And showrunners are getting thin. There's just a lot of shows out there.
That's a great point. That's a great point. I never really thought about that. I mean, over the last 10 years, the number of scripted shows has just exploded. And
yep.
I can't imagine the number of showrunners has exploded.
Well, the good ones, are hard. I'm going to put us in the category of solid, there's a lot of guys out there that are running shows that probably would like to have a little more experience. But, it's a tough job. And experience goes a long way when you're spending that kind of money,
That's great. I mean, one of the other questions I had, you guys have been a partnership for a long time. Has there been pressure for them to split you guys up, or do they like the way things work?
No one's ever weighed in on that, to be honest with you. No one's ever said, yeah, we want to split you up. I think that, to be perfectly honest with you, I think the pressure goes the other way and again, this would be strictly from a financial standpoint. It's like if you get enough leverage, you say you got to pay us as two people instead of as a partnership.
Yeah.
So it's never coming the other direction.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or it never has, at least in our partnership, where anyone's put that pressure on us. It would be, I think it's seen as our own decision.
Okay. Well, one of the other things I wanted to ask about your backgrounds, you guys both came from acting, and I know, Patrick, I saw you even had a couple arcs on some major shows, like Next Generation back in the day. You guys had some experience in that mm-hmm. realm before. What does that do to inform, as an actor, what does that do to inform your writing?
John played a doctor on Friday Night Lights. That was
I did notice that, actually.
He was in Mexico, and he was, injecting people with shark blood or shark serum or
something. Anyway,
really a great role. I think it just informed us in terms of how a scene can work and how it comes out of the actor's mouth. Literally, you could look at a scene and go, this scene is very well written, but how is it going to play? And I think when you're an actor or you work working around actors in plays, you can sort of get a better ear for what's actually going to play on the screen and what's not. I think that's the one thing that would be my takeaway.
Yeah, I concur. I just think, I think that we approach a scene from a more practical standpoint because of our background in acting. You kind of know what an actor can say and make it sound real. Now, we're not always right, but I'm not going to pretend that we're like the greatest dialogue writers in the world. I think we are solid. But even with that experience, you always know it when you hear it. And maybe the advantage is that we hear it in our heads a little bit more easily than someone who doesn't have acting experience. But eventually you're going to be sitting in a room someday and you're going to be casting, and the scene that you thought was genius, the first actor's going to come in and it's going to be terrible. and you're going to blame the actor. The second actor comes in, they're not so good either. You can blame the actor. The third actor comes in, they're not so good. At some point, you got to start blaming the scene. And then, you know, so once it starts coming out of when actors try to act your stuff, if it's not working, your scene's not working. And I think maybe we're a half step ahead of that game just because we have some acting experience.
Oh, great. Well, let's wrap it up there with one last question. And Patrick, I'll start with you. If you have one piece of advice for writers out there who are listening, what would that piece of advice be?
Stay in your chair. Be prolific. You know, I think that it's really, for me, that's for me. I mean, some guys can do it, can shorthand it. For me, I had to write a lot to become good at this. It's hard. Writing screenplays is hard. I think you need to accept that pretty early on. It's fun. It's great when you have a partner because you have someone to bounce ideas off of, mm-hmm. someone to be, you know, go through frustrations with and all that stuff. But if you're either with a partner or you're alone, just keep writing. You'll get better. You'll see improvement. And it's also something you can do your entire life and continue to improve as you get older. It's like playing the guitar or something. You can improve. So yeah, I think that's it pretty much. Just work your ass off and stick with it if you believe in it.
That's great. John, how about you?
I got to say same thing. It's, you know, there's the art, but it's a lot of craft, and you do get better, and you start to feel the rhythm of scripts the more you do it. And it gets easier to be proficient and competent. It's not always going to be great because that's where the art part comes in. You can't guarantee that. But you can make your craft better. And once you get a certain amount of mileage under your belt, you become a professional. And like I said, that doesn't mean you're always going to be great, but it does mean you're always going to be professional. So Patrick said it best, just stay in your chair, write. The other piece of advice I give young writers is if you only wrote one page a day, you'd write 365 pages a year, which is a couple of screenplays.
Yeah,
maybe it's three screenplays actually. So don't get intimidated by the bigness of a story. Bite-sized pieces, break it down, structure it, make sure, you know, the pieces all fit together, and then just start.
Yeah.
page a day. You'll probably find you'll write five or six.
And here's like one little thing that I like to say to young writers too. It's kind of stupid, but it's kind of cool too. The greatest writer in the world, we could all, I think, agree, the greatest dramatist was William Shakespeare. He wrote about 32 plays or something. Half of those are unproducible, okay? So if you think, I mean, Timmins of Athens, I mean, fuck. I mean, the whole Henry VI, hey, listen, if the greatest writer, dramatist in the world is batting 500, you know, keep that in mind. It's hard, you know, and don't give up. Just, you know, write a lot and good things will happen.
That's great. That is a great place to leave it, guys. Thank you so much for joining us and doing this with us.
Real pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you, man.
And you guys can check out Gold in theaters in January coming up. If you like the podcast, please let us know by leaving us a review or a rating on iTunes. And until next time, I'm Pete D'Alessandro signing off.